I want to say, welcome back to January, because that's when I'm writing this, but that's still Q1. My RPM won't be back up till sometime between May and November. Get ready for some more niche history. Ibrahim II is a man who, if you type his name into YouTube, you'll find Brian Oblivion's VHS recording of what I think is a local Knoxville band circa 2004. But this is the Arabian Ivan the Terrible, the Emir Dasad, or he just might have been a mama's boy trying to make himself look tough. Let's find out. This video is brought to you by longtime supporters of the channel, Magellan TV. Magellan TV is a documentary streaming service made by filmmakers with over 3,000 titles to choose from in history, science, nature, and much more. I've been watching their documentary on the last Empress of Iran. You'll see why that might be somewhat relevant in the next episode, but it's a really interesting look at the Iranian Revolution and what happened to the royal family once the monarchy was abolished and replaced with a republic led by a supreme leader, which is totally different. It's a good time. Go check it out. MagellanTV.com/JackRackham. You get 30 days totally free. Okay, since I'm guessing 9th century Tunisia isn't a topic most of you are familiar with, let me catch you up on where this part of the world is at. Islam appears, Rashidun Caliphate conquers the Middle East except Turkey. Now, if you recall the video I made on Ali, there were a bunch of governors from the Umayyad family who rebelled against him, and without going into too many spoilers, I'll just say they ended up conquering the rest of North Africa, and a good 95% of Spain at that, so at its height, the Islamic Caliphate stretched all the way from the Indus River to the Atlantic Ocean, and was the single largest empire the world had ever seen up to that point. But by the time you get to the middle of the Abbasid dynasty, the Muslim world isn't just one big block anymore. For one, there's the remnants of the old regime living in exile in Al-Andalus. Then, the group that assassinated Ali, called the Khawarij, whom I always imagine like an Islamic Illuminati for their ability to appear out of nowhere and destabilize governments for centuries, even though they were just a loosely united radical religious sect. They cause enough trouble for the Abbasids in Morocco that someone new takes charge of the region. Persia's doing its own thing now, but even inside the caliphate, you've got these dynasties of emirs like the Tulanids in Egypt who are just paying some taxes every year and otherwise doing whatever the hell they want. And one of those do-whatever-the-hell-they-want dynasties is the Aghlabids in Africa, which is actually the name of this province here, but it sounds like I'm just being super vague, so for simplicity, we're keeping it in Arabic and calling it Afrika. And these guys, it took them a while to get the ball rolling, but they're doing pretty good all by themselves. I mean, they're sitting on Carthage, it's prime real estate, they've got fertile land, they expanded the robust irrigation system left over from the Romans, they're tapping into that sweet Eastern Mediterranean trade network, they even carved up Sicily. In fact, Ibrahim's dad was more or less the zenith of the Aghlabid dynasty. By 863, the good times were rolling. Then he dies, naturally, and Ibrahim's uncle, dead in a couple months. Ibrahim's brother is in charge. And while Ibrahim is a serious and studious governor, his brother, not so much. He's gonna sit back and ride out the good times, come what may. What came was plague. Lots of plague. Conveniently, however, Ibrahim's brother died. Not sure if the plague got him, but even if he lived, he probably wouldn't have lasted too long with the peasants watching him kick back in opulence while they died in the streets. Regardless, everyone's so excited for Ibrahim to be in charge, they forgot his brother had a son and they put him to work. Luckily, the emirate may have lost its health, but it hadn't lost its wealth. Within about a year of taking the throne, Ibrahim built a whole new imperial palace city to get away from the hustle and bustle and plague of the real city. I want to compare it to the Forbidden City in Beijing. That wouldn't be entirely accurate since this was more like a planned capital and not just a palace complex, but it's still pretty darn impressive. At the same time, he got the country back on its feet by boosting law enforcement to clear out all the bandit camps popping up so that people could trade again, so that he could tax them again, so that he could pay for the ginormous capital city going up in his backyard. But the people appreciated not getting shanked on their way out of town anymore. The people also appreciated all the other cool stuff he built in the next 10 years or so. More irrigation, new city walls, a giant reservoir, these really fancy mosques, and a whole bunch of signal fires along the coast that could carry a message from Morocco to Alexandria in a day. Not sure why that's the reference when neither of those places are in Africa, but there you have it. You don't need to live in hoity-toity Baghdad to get decent amenities. He even held an open court every Friday where people could come in and let him know what's giving them trouble, and even if they brought a case against their local lords, even if it was his own family, most of the time he'd rule in favor of the peasants. So what went wrong here? Well, nothing. Everything was going according to plan. This wasn't about giving power to the people, it was about crippling the aristocracy to obtain unlimited power. He must have admired the Abbasid caliphs because he definitely imitated them. He saw their Turkish mercenaries and decided he too wanted a personal corps of soldiers with no ties to the local nobility, so he bought a slave army. This cost a lot of money, but guess who has that? The local nobility! It's brilliant, brilliant, brilliant! Some nobles revolt, as is to be expected, but he learns from the wisdom of Caliph As-Safa. And I know there's like two people out there thinking, oh, I know where this is going. He agrees to settle the dispute diplomatically and humbly receives about 1,000 of the rebels as his honored guests. And he kills them all in their sleep. You really only get to pull that trick once, but man did he ever. The empire he was ostensibly part of was literally founded on that exact scenario, and he still pulled it off by spending more than a decade being so self-disciplined and humble at all times. That plan was really well executed. The other nobles aren't so impressed. I'd wager to say even less impressed than you were with that pun. That means now the unrest in the mountainous hinterlands is a raging rebellion across most of the emirate. Even Sicily's tearing itself apart, and the biggest cities are the ones that hate him the most. But you know, in hindsight, that isolated palace was such a good investment. The amazing thing, even if it kind of sucked for all involved, is that Ibrahim's personal army manages to effectively reconquer the entire country from scratch. I mean, these guys have mastered the art of war, and he can easily replace the casualties, and if they stay at home, they might start to threaten him anyway. You know, it'd be a shame just to have them sitting around in Afrika. These guys need to be on campaign. Egypt looks like it could use an invasion. Back in Ibrahim's early reign, right after Egypt gained its pseudo-independence, they actually invaded Ifriqiya and took like half of it before a Khawarij tribe of all things came riding down the mountains to save the day like they're Gandalf the White. So A, Ibrahim's got a bone to pick with them, and B, last time he fought Egypt, he ended up looting a lot of money from their supply train, so just think what kind of goodies they must have at home. He didn't take their land, because everything west of the Nile is pretty desolate anyway, but he gave them a good knuckle sandwich. The most significant casualty ended up being Ibrahim's cousin, who'd been put in charge of Ifriqiya in the emir's absence, because the caliph wrote a letter saying, "Boy, this guy's doing a great job, Ibrahim, why can't you be more like your cousin?" And Ibrahim had him executed and his body fixed to a pole. Where to invade next? Why, how about the people who came to the rescue that time Egypt invaded? Now, to be fair, they had a history with Ifriqiya and laid claims to some of the same areas around Tunisia, which they might actually have occupied during the first war with Egypt. My biggest scholarly source here is in Italian, so grains of salt all around. But the point is, he invaded them, took their land, and then supposedly had the prisoners line up in front of him single file so that he could personally stab them to death. And supposedly, he killed 500 of them before he got tired, which must have been a huge relief for Mr. 501. There's also a rumor that he supposedly cooked and ate the heads of 15 other enemies, but like, why the heads? There's no meat there, no wonder he had to cook 15 of them, they were probably a collective appetizer. Meanwhile, there's 15 perfectly good tenderloins going to waste. Hopefully you've noticed that the word supposedly is doing a lot of work here, and that's because there's no way to be sure exactly how much of this is true. Maybe he went stark raving mad and started killing everybody. Maybe he had a lot of enemies who spread rumors about him being a tyrant because he invaded two countries and massacred hundreds of rebels when they tried to talk with him about taxes. Maybe he gave up on being loved and decided he needed to be feared, so he committed unspeakable atrocities in the name of politics. Or maybe he spread rumors about himself doing that without having to waste a Saturday watching people's lungs come out of their stomachs. Do I believe he did all this stuff? Not really, but just for fun, here's a selection of what he's been accused of over the years. He killed 8 brothers and 1 son. He strangled a few wives, dismembered a few, and locked a few more in a dark room and threw away the key. He heard there was a plot to assassinate him, and just to be safe, he killed every errand boy in the palace. His mom bought him slaves for a present. He re-gifted her their severed heads. He killed every one of his daughters at birth, but had so many that he missed a few, so he threw them a sweet 16 and cut off their heads. He found a napkin out of place and executed 300 servants. He heard that one bodyguard might be gay, so he smashed his head in with a mace. Everyone in the room breathed a sigh of relief that Ibrahim was feeling merciful that day, and then he called for a brazier to burn the rest of them alive. True or not, though, those rumors made their way back to Baghdad, and the caliph was less than chuffed. Ifriqiya was mostly autonomous, but they still sent in money every year, and the Abbasid caliphate still had an army, so if they really wanted someone gone, they were gone. So Ibrahim receives a letter from the caliph informing him that the way he's treating his subjects is whack, and he needs to give his crown to his son and come back to Baghdad to be grounded or else. Ibrahim writes back and says he'll do it. He didn't even invite the caliph to a party. He's shockingly remorseful. He freed his slaves, he let people out of prison, he emptied his coffers to the poor. It's almost like he was trying to put his government in a weaker position so that he would have to come back and save it later. He was going to Baghdad, but he was bringing an army with him. But don't be fooled, this wasn't a war with the caliphate. Oh no, this was much bigger. Having finally rebuilt his navy after a disastrous defeat 20 years ago, and finally getting the Arabs in Sicily to quit rebelling, he decides to take his entire army, his personal army, the local regiments, new volunteers, everybody, and go on tour to prove to the caliph that he was indispensable. First, he was going to put an end to Byzantine rule in Sicily after 80 years of back and forth. Then he was going to launch into southern Italy, sack every city that didn't surrender at once, carve through the small kingdoms of Naples, Salerno, Benevento, then up through northern Italy, defeat the Franks, torch Rome if he had to, then march through Croatia, Serbia, Bulgaria, plunge deep into Byzantine Thrace, tear down the Theodosian walls of Constantinople, and rip out the empire's beating heart by subjugating the city for the glory of the caliphate, then scoop up Anatolia, sail down the Tigris River to Baghdad, and just see how much the caliph wants to fire him then. And so, in 902, the plan begins. Ibrahim raises his banner and adds droves of volunteers to the ranks of the army that has already defeated most of North Africa at one point or another. The Byzantines have but one fortress that might save them, but Ibrahim's men climb a vertical cliff over the backside of the castle and burst open the gates from the inside. Sicily crumbles, towns across southern Italy surrender for fear of what this man who slaughters his own subjects would do to his enemies. The few castles who resist, they're gonna fall any day now, and then, oh, this has become an ordeal. Oh, the men want to go home. Oh, Ibrahim is sick. He's got dysentery, and he's dead.